Pnawn dda, Laura. Diolch yn fawr iawn am fod yma. Croeso i State of the Union. Delighted to have you with us today, or with me. Laura, I want to start with the pandemic. It's absolutely undeniable that it's had a huge impact on people's understanding of devolution. So whether that's the role of the mayors in England, whether it's the roles of the first ministers, people now understand what is devolved, what isn't, what's in the gift of Westminster, much more than they ever have done. What material impact do you think that's going to have in the future?
I think you're right. It's been the biggest fillip to public understanding and consciousness of the distinctive governments of the UK. And one would expect that when the key public policy areas that are most relevant to COVID, you know, around health and around education and to a degree employment, although there's a jagged edge there, of course, with furlough, have been treated differently in each of the nations. It's also exceptional circumstances, isn't it, where politics touches on people's everyday lives in the most dramatic way. So, you know, the conversations you have with neighbours and friends and people on the school run about Mark Drakeford's decisions on a Friday review. I mean, who would have imagined that we would have been having that kind of direct engagement with political policymaking a little over a year ago. So in that respect, you know, there's something quite positive. It's hard to find much positive about the pandemic, but there's something quite positive in terms of consciousness of the reality of devolution. But in other respects, you know, there's also a risk attached to that, because people at times of crisis can make very individualized judgments and critiques on political action. And if you just take the lockdown restrictions, I think clearly they will have had very differential impacts depending on one's socioeconomic status, the type of employment one's in, whether one has children and so on. And sometimes, you know, then politics becomes hugely personalized and individualized in a way that it normally isn't. So I think, you know, there's pros and cons about the massive exposure of the reality of devolution in this crisis that could serve a country like Wales well, where knowledge was so poor before, but equally there's a risk attached to that too.
And it's interesting. And at the beginning of the lockdown last year, I mean, it's amazing to think it was a year ago, you wrote a piece in the Western Mail about the unionist approach to the union. And I think a lot of the argument that you were pursuing then stemmed from some of the themes you've just been talking about. You use this line, unionists are the ones that are more likely to destroy the union. What do you mean by that? What is it specifically that they are doing which is causing a shift in opinion?
Yeah, that's been a bit of a theme for me before last year, to be honest, Anthony, in that I think I said this first publicly. I've always sensed it, because I've got a lot of friends who are committed unionists, and I often sort of talk to them about why the union is important to them. And a lot of the language that they use and the narrative and emotion that they use is quite different to what I was hearing from political unionists, i.e. key politicians in the UK Labour Party and the UK Conservative Party. So it just struck me that there was a bit of a disconnect there in terms of understandings of the union. And then when I thought about it more, I felt that there was a kind of lazy acceptance or arrogance around the very existence and continuation of the union. There was a kind of sense that what else could people do? That independence, for example, for Scotland or for Wales, or reunification of Northern Ireland with the Republic, was almost fanciful, that it was, you know, people wouldn't go for it. And it struck me when I first mentioned this, and actually I remember when I first mentioned it, because it was in my Patrick Hannon lecture, BBC lecture in the Hay Festival, and I think that was in 2015, so, you know, 6 years ago now. I just got a sense that unionists would jeopardize the union more than nationalists because of that lazy arrogance. And in fact, if anything, that's gained more traction since that time for a couple of reasons. I mean, clearly the Labour Party's had its own internal problems and has left quite a big political vacuum for the Conservatives and indeed the right to move into. And it's been able to project a version of the union that is effectively an understanding based on England. And you know, don't get me wrong, I can see entirely why England needs to feature front and centre in any discussion of the union because of its size and its population base. But the nature of a voluntary union is all about redistribution of attention as much as resource. And so, yes, Wales might just constitute just over 3 million of the population and Scotland, you know, 5 million. But the reality is, without the goodwill and the buy-in from those nations, the union is nothing. It doesn't exist. And it just felt to me that that was a pretty risky, I hesitate to say strategy, because I don't think it is a strategy by unionists, but a pretty risky default position to slip into, because by in so doing, you leave space for independence campaigners and for a nationalist position on politics in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. And equally, you're probably misinterpreting your base. I mean, if you look at the debate now about Englishness and England, you know, it's pretty clear that that is an underexplored area of our identities in these isles. My colleague Richard Wynne-Jones has just published a really important book on this. But, you know, the fact that nobody has talked of or in any depth or analysed English identity until now in a political context seems to me to be connected with this rather casual interpretation of the value of the union. I mean, I don't mind what position anybody takes, whether they are pro-union or anti-union, but surely politically and philosophically, it's important for unionists to treat the union with regard, care and respect if they want it to continue. And my argument about unionists destroying the union was based on what I could see, which seemed to me to be the antithesis of that.
It's really interesting. We've had conversations in recent weeks with John Curtis, amongst others. And one of the things that John Curtis said to us was that, you know, there will be an emerging case, no doubt, at some stage in Scotland around what unionism is good for people in Scotland if there is that second referendum. And language is important, but also a unified argument is important as well. And we're likely, if we do see that in Scotland, it'll be interesting to see what that argument is in other parts of the United Kingdom where we are seeing some divergence in opinion. I mean, there has been huge uptick in Wales, as you've seen with Yes Cymru. Obviously, there's huge conversations going around in Northern Ireland with the centenary approaching in June. What do you sense is the union's strongest card to play? Because we hear lots about what separatists would argue for. What is it that you think unionists should say more of in light of some of those things that you've just said?
Well, I struggle with a lot of the language of the narrative to start with, and I think a lot of people do. You know, I think you've used some terms there like separatism and unionism, and I've used them too. I'm not criticising. I certainly used unionism. And I think the language is problematic, particularly for a younger generation, and they're the critical players in this in many regards, because it's amongst the youngest people that there's less support or least support for the union and more support for alternative constitutional futures, including independence. You know, I think this kind of idea of separatism just doesn't chime with younger voters whatsoever. As far as they're concerned, they've grown up in a devolution era. All they're used to is knowing that the Senedd has control over key aspects of their lives, but that power is also shared and competences are shared with Westminster and until recently with the European Union as well. And so for them, I don't think that language makes much sense. So I would, as a very simple starter, I think unionists have to move away from the notion that there is only one form of constitutional organisation that is valid and all others are regarded as distinctive or separate. I think that's important. Then I think unionists have to really bottom out what is the concept of voluntary association that underpins the union. It can't be about telling or it can't be about doing for, because we've moved into our third decade of devolution now. And I don't think it's acceptable for a UK government to tell Scotland and Wales how money will be spent or how policies will be enacted. And that requires a change in mentality as much as machinery. I've always felt this about intergovernmental relations, never mind a debate about the union. Intergovernmental relations in the UK have been abysmally handled over the last decade, in my opinion. And that's been because of a mindset that devolution was about granting of power from the centre to the regions and nations, and that sovereignty was still held very tight in the fist of Westminster and Whitehall. And I'm afraid that's determined a lot of the behaviours and attitudes of officials and politicians in Westminster. And it hasn't served the Union terribly well. So I think we've got to change the mindset so that we, if we want the UK to survive, we've got to look at least being respectful to a quasi-federal model of politics. And I say quasi because moving to a federal model requires a lot of commitment from England to buy into this. And at the moment, that's hard to see. But it is quasi because devolution means nothing if it can be stamped upon or dragged back or pulled away by the UK government. And until the UK government feels confident in its own authority and its relationship with the nations, and I'm afraid that is probably a handmaiden of destruction for the Union. So I think the language has got to change fundamentally. And then I think there's got to be some really serious trenchant analysis of the economic and international benefits, I guess, of staying together within a voluntary union. I think that could be, that could centre on macroeconomic policy and a green economy. Now, clearly, Scotland and Wales will argue that they too could advance that side of a revised economy. I think it could centre on a foundational economy, on, you know, uniform, universal basic income, shorter working weeks, and principles that would work well across the UK. But if the UK government, for whatever reason, whether that's politically or policy or philosophically, doesn't want to buy into those, I think it's got to think of another narrative that will appeal to the nations. And at the moment, I can't imagine what that could be because the politics is playing out differently in each country.
Mm. Well, I use the S word, you use the F word, so I think we're probably even. The really interesting dynamic, Laura, is, in Wales at the moment, is the movement that's happening in Welsh Labour. So I don't think you would argue that there are many in the Welsh Conservative movement who are comfortable with the idea of independence, but there certainly are in Welsh Labour. And Welsh Labour, historically, during my time in Welsh politics, was unionist, probably with a small U, but it was unionist all the same. It's thought that possibly a third of their voters now are probably pro-independence. What is the dynamic, in your opinion, that's happening within Welsh Labour? What's driving this change in attitude, mood? And is it important? Will we see new things in the new Welsh parliamentary session that, you know, might reflect this new voter base potentially?
Yeah, I think it is important. I don't think anyone could argue it isn't important because, as you said, the Labour Party is historically and technically a unionist party. I mean, the Welsh Labour is a brand at the end of the day. It's not a reality, in all honesty. And we've seen that, you know, played out in all its negatives, as well as played well for Welsh Labour in terms of Welsh elections. So I think we've got to recognise that the fact that a lot of Labour voters, I'm a little bit cynical about numbers because clearly we've got very little in the way of polling data about, you know, in terms of samples on Labour voters. But there's no doubt, you know, anecdotally, and there's a sense that Welsh Labour voters are warm to the concept of independence. I think you can trace that back to the kind of soft nationalism of Welsh Labour, the way it's been played out since devolution, you know, under Rodri Morgan, as well as Carwyn Jones, and now under Mark Drakeford, this kind of idea that, you know, devolution is about autonomy, that Wales can do things differently, the clear red water, of course, as it was known. So I think, you know, it's made it difficult for Plaid Cymru in a way that Scottish Labour made it easy for the SNP, if you follow my point. And of course, what that's meant for Welsh Labour is that they've already advanced some way towards being more relaxed about greater autonomy. And therefore, with a kind of populist movement like Yes Cymru, it was inevitable that that would get some real traction with Welsh Labour voters. I have to say, I think that's amongst the younger generation of Welsh Labour voters. Again, I haven't got evidence for that, but I sense that, you know, if you take the older generation age-wise of Welsh Labour, particularly in maybe the valleys areas, there's still a really strong sense of kind of Britishness as well as Welshness there. And in fact, some of that Britishness is pretty much based on symbols of the Union that younger people would find anathema, like the royal family, the Union Jack, and so on. And, you know, that's where I think Labour is potentially in conflict with itself, really, that it needs those voters to stay on board, yet as well, it needs to reinvent itself with the next generation of voters. Interestingly, though, I think, Anthony, is the kind of conversations that are going on now in Welsh Labour around radical federalism. And, you know, I think there's a lot, there's a whole host of problems with federalism. You know, let's not beat around the bush, not least the kind of English issue right in the middle of it. But I still think it's a useful and potentially constructive exercise for Welsh Labour to debate about alternatives to the status quo. And they don't have to be independence or scrap the assembly altogether. I think there's a lot of space in the middle there of the constitutional ground where we could be having proper conversations about how a new UK might be cast. Massive execution difficulties with all of that, as we said. But nevertheless, you know, we've slagged off Labour over the years for not really addressing the constitutional question. And now at least there seems to be some appetite to have conversations about, you know, a more radical construction beyond devolution. I think all of this comes from the fact, and people in the Conservative Party in Wales have acknowledged this, at least the ones that I think about the constitution, that the union has to be recast differently. We can't just expect this union to put itself back together after the turmoil of Brexit, Scottish independence referendum, and possibly another one, growth in support for Welsh independence, and then the whole Northern Ireland question. I don't think we can expect that to be just sellotaped or sticking plastered back together. And even the Conservatives, I say even only because, you know, Conservatives are a unionist party, even the Conservatives are thinking that there has to be some alternative to that.
And more broadly then, 50 days to go until the Senedd elections, what will you be looking out for? What are the elements in this election which make it different, make it interesting, make it exciting, but maybe not, yeah, too much.
You know, it's such a difficult one, isn't it? Because, you know, if you'd asked me this question a year ago now, just before we knew about COVID and the lockdown, I would have answered straight away, this is the election where Plaid Cymru has to make a breakthrough. Because let's be perfectly honest, it seems odd starting with Plaid because they're the third party, but let's think of it. They've got a new leader that they presented as being the saviour of the party and the leader, the first minister in waiting. And yet Plaid's been quite stubbornly bumping along in the polls in third position a lot of the time. Yes, they've had their moments, but, you know, the reality is that the moments haven't been big enough or great enough for a party that's got aspirations to govern. And of course, maybe that would have played out differently if we hadn't then had COVID, because of course, COVID then gave that big platform to Welsh Labour. Broadly, the Welsh public are supportive of the Welsh government's actions, more supportive than they are of the UK government's interventions anyway. It's also given a big platform to the First Minister, and consciousness of who he is has been boosted by COVID. And it's been difficult, hasn't it? Not just for Plaid, but for all the opposition parties, including the Conservatives, to actually attack government policy in the middle of a pandemic. So that's made for very different terrain, really, in the lead up to this election. I think most of us were expecting it to be a more closely fought contest between the two parties of the left, Plaid and Labour, with the Welsh Conservatives also, you know, riding the wave of Boris Johnson's success in the last UK general election. It could still happen, don't forget, because our electoral system does effectively compensate parties that lose out on the first ballot through the regional ballot. So we could still see a really interesting three-way split. But the way it looks at the moment, it looks like we've almost gone back to our default position in Wales, which is voting Labour predominantly. So it's hard to imagine that Labour will come out of the election with fewer than 25 seats. I know there's been a poll that's shown that, but I think we need to take that with a pinch of salt at the moment. So if Labour has a poor election and comes out with, say, 24, 25, 26 seats, then I think that's interesting, because it's difficult to govern as a minority government, obviously, in that situation, particularly as there's likely to be a kind of rump of, you know, hard right populist MSs there, even if it's two or three. possibly an independent. So, you know, that makes it problematic. It makes it interesting, of course, because the Conservatives have so few options for getting influence in government other than winning outright. And winning outright is extremely difficult for the Conservatives in our electoral system. So where the action is then is between Labour and Plaid. And, you know, we've all heard Adam Price say he won't prop up a Labour First Minister. But, you know, Plaid and Labour's options are also limited. Do they want to, for example, try and sustain a minority Labour government? If that collapses, go back to the polls. Voters don't like that. We all know that. Do they want to try and cobble together a deal that isn't based on a formal coalition? Will they share the First Minister's position? Of course, that depends on Plaid doing much better than they're anticipated to do. So there's lots of interesting options around this. But I think the fundamental issue for me is that this is going to be a different election to the one we thought it would be 13 months ago. Other factors to bear in mind, Anthony, are we've got 16 and 17 year olds voting for the first time. I hope they turn out in large numbers, but, you know, the proposals to properly integrate some political education and civic education in schools has had a big hit from schools being closed. So, you know, who knows on that front as well. But, you know, it's adding another 70,000 electors, potential electors to the electoral roll. So that adds an element of uncertainty as well in some key marginal constituencies.
We'll be watching. And finally, another election. You're standing for the FIFA Council, as a UEFA.
I am.
What's your pitch? How's it going?
What's my elevator pitch? Well, it's going very well, thank you, at the moment. I'm trying to meet with all 54 other UEFA nations. So that involves quite a lot of effort. But the good thing is that obviously with COVID restrictions, I'm not able to travel around Europe meeting. So I'm able to do more because it's by Teams and Zoom. So, I mean, it involves meeting, you know, one day meeting maybe Kosovo, the next day Germany, the next day the Faroe Islands, the next day France, you know, so all the way from the very big superpowers to the relatively small players in UEFA, but they've all got the same vote, which is a salutary lesson to campaigners, of course, that they're equally important to us. So I'm meeting with as many of those. My pitch is very clear. I'm standing against an opponent who's not from a football background, where my background is very much in the game. You know, I'm a former player. I was captain of Wales, and I've been involved in the administration and governance of football since I retired. So my pitch is very much I'm the football candidate and I can be a voice on FIFA for UEFA and for football as a whole, not just women's football, but football as a whole. And then finally, I think I'm trying to tap into the zeitgeist in the game now for reform, pushing the integrity of the game, modernization, diversity in its governance. And that does fit well with the agenda of the president, Gianni Infantino, and indeed the UEFA president, Alexander Seferin. So I'm hoping that will be enough. But make no mistake, for me to win, it will be a real political earthquake because I'm up against one of the big superpowers in world football in Italy. And, you know, we're underdogs, we're the minnows. But, you know, sometimes the underdog wins as well. So we're going to give it everything.
Well, we're rooting for you. So very best of luck. And thank you very much.